Josue. I take my state board exam tomorrow. My instructor said, do something relaxing the day before your exam. So here I am.
Oh, good.
That's awesome. That's, I'm glad we're relaxing.
I'm glad we're relaxing.
I've never been told that before.
No.
I've been told I stress people out, but that's cool. I'm glad you're here, Josue.
Hey, we're live. How's everybody going? How's everybody doing?
Stopping by to give thanks. Continuing education for dog owners and trainers is mandatory and grateful.
Awesome. Dogs just stop doing bad shit. It's incredible. And then you get to start training your dog. Hey, everybody. How are you? It's Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training. And hope everybody is doing okay. And let's see here. We got everything, all of our settings all set.
We're good.
Okay, excellent. So, my name is Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training. We've been on the road for a little bit. We're back. It's good to be back. Came back late last night.
It's great to be back.
It's been a debacle coming back. It's been a debacle being away.
Everything's been interesting.
Everything's been a debacle.
Everything.
But we had a great first. You want this?
Oh yeah, I like that. One better.
We had a great first seminar of the year down in.
Pearson, Florida
at Ashley's place. Thank you, Ashley, for being a wonderful host.
She's the best.
It was wonderful. It was fantastic to meet all of you. We helped so many people of you. That was wonderful. It was really, really enjoyable.
Jeff can't speak tonight.
I can't speak tonight. I'm pretty exhausted. But the way this is going to be, it's a Q&A show, and you ask a question, we give you an answer. You know, the answers I wish could be really, really longer. But if you take the overall theme of the show, which is basically based on stopping unwanted behaviors, if you listen to a lot of the questions are how to stop, you'll get an answer that says, you know, apply a punisher. And the reason is because that's how you stop unwanted behaviors. You're not going to reward your dog out of an unwanted behavior. The seminars, which we do, are two-day seminars. Again, those are punishment heavy because people are trying to get us to literally stop an unwanted behavior so they can live a better life. The dogs that we get in on these seminars, people are really, really struggling. And I think
Florida had a wild bunch.
And I think that's what people are really struggling with. And I think that's what people, why we get portrayed in this really negative light of trainers. But if you came to our training center and you saw what we do every day here, it is a combination of I would say a ton of reward-based training and repetition. And repetition, you can't hide from that. There's no shortcut to that. No matter what tools you use, there's no shortcut to that.
Got to put the reps in.
I don't know how many times we said that this weekend.
That's like a new slogan. Got to put the reps
in. Yeah, that and next and make it suck and all the other ones that we have. And then the seminar series, which is jeffgelmanseminars.com. And you can check that out. We're going to be in.
What's next? Here?
Frederick, Maryland, and then here, and then Portland, Oregon. All right. So ask your questions. It looks like a lot of you are. Also, there's something called Top Chat. And the Top Chat is what you can do is a lot of people like to, you know, you do not have to pay to play, but your question goes to the top of the queue. And we'll answer that immediately. But we tried our best to get through every single question. So I think that's really, really important. I think that's it for now. I think we should just start going and see where it goes. And we'll see if there's any rants going on. And you might hear Angelo's name in the background because Angelo's here. You just heard it right now. We are going to start doing an earlier show, though. I think we're going to try to stick to a 7 a.m. start time. 7 p.m. start time. 7 a.m. we could do, but that'd be a little bit early. And I think the reason we're doing that is because the nights have been going too long. Our days have been going too long, and I think it's time to start consolidating those nights down. So here we go.
Let's go. Gretchen, welcome back. We missed you guys. You look good, Joelle.
Joelle always looks good.
Not feeling good last week. I'm glad to be back.
Yeah, last week.
We were so sick.
That's another thing.
And it's funny because the show we did last Saturday, we both got the sniffles mid-show and we're like, are we getting sick? And then literally the next day, we both woke up. I texted you. I'm like, I can't even go to work today. I had a fever of really over 100. It was literally that next morning. Yeah.
Yeah. It's been a crazy week. It's been a crazy week, but I'm looking forward to getting, you know, I'm still struggling a little bit, but I'm looking forward to getting back into full health. And I haven't been to the gym, and you haven't been to the gym, and we traveled, and everything you're supposed to do to get better, we did not do.
We did not do.
Yeah. Except for a little bit of sleep and eating. I barely ate. Anyway, let's keep moving on. Let's not talk about that next.
Kyle, hi guys. My friend has a male Doberman that is now 18 months old. I've known him well since 16 weeks. Last week when I went to my friend's house, he started growling at me and is now very uncomfortable.
I think that happens a lot with 18-month-old dogs. I think in 9-month-old dogs, it happens a lot. I think a lot of times with a lot of people, I think behavior gets away from them. It might have been a slow, gradual thing. It might have been one big whammy. I think you might be putting a lot of pressure on the dog. Maybe you didn't realize it. I think just some dogs also just turn into a new stage of their life at 18 months old. I've seen dogs with exemplary behavior all of a sudden at 18 months old, totally switch. Mm-hmm. Totally switch. And Angela, you're making too much noise in the background. So I think it's really, really important. It's really, really important that, people understand that sometimes you just don't know until you know. So next time you go over the house, just try to exist around the dog. I don't know what the owner is doing as far as correcting any of this behavior. If it's worse with other people, what the owner has done, frankly, growling for you, just hanging out, if that's what you're doing, is just not acceptable. Next.
One big weirdo. Hey, Jeff and Joelle. My on-leash 60-pound bulldog attacked a 20-pound dog off-leash after the dog ran up to us out of nowhere. The owner was shocked. Could this have been avoided with more training?
You know what? It's what's done is done. So, it's hard to say. I said, you know, sure, you could have done a better job, and then here you are going to be feeling guilty. I think even the best dogs on a leash, when an off-leash dog runs at them, goes in and attacks. I think chances are you're holding your dog back. You're probably trying to keep the other dog safe. And unfortunately, that probably created, kicked in drive into your dog. But a ton of dogs, my dogs, might most likely would have done the same thing. The bottom line is if you were in an on-leash area and an off-leash dog ran up to you, it sucks. You're not liable, but that doesn't discount the fact that your dog hurt another dog. Don't get me wrong. I'm not being cold and uncaring, but it happens more and more and more. And if you're going to have your dog off leash in an on-leash area, or even in an off-leash area, your dog could run away and get hit by a car. Mm-hmm. You are taking a chance. That dog obviously did not have recall. It didn't have recall, so it didn't go back to its owner. And for this concept that a dog can just come running up to any dog that it wants to and say hi because it's quote unquote friendly, unfortunately, look what happens. Next.
Mothman, welcome back. I hope you enjoyed the warmth down in Florida. Very happy to be watching the podcast again.
Actually, it wasn't all that freaking warm.
Oh my God, Saturday was really cold.
It was actually really cold down there. It was like 40.
Sunday was beautiful.
Yeah, so it was 43 or something like that. It was not warm.
For one day, I know, and we heard about it for the whole day.
Yes.
Sunday was nice.
What are you trying to imply, just for me?
Yes.
From everybody. Everybody was cold. Sunday was nice. You were cold. You had to borrow a jacket. Everybody was cold. Yeah. Next.
But Sunday was great.
Sunday was beautiful. And the trip was beautiful. Next.
Melissa, good evening, Jeff and Joelle and everyone in the chat. How was Mardi Gras?
Mardi Gras, believe it or not, it's not my thing.
Not my cup of tea.
It really is not. I think visually, if I was sitting inside watching and observing it, I think it would be fine. But it's not my thing. At this stage of my life, it's just not my thing. I see why people like it. Everyone seemed to be having a really, really good time. We didn't go into, you know, the huge, humongo, big band area. It was more about where Sean and Marta live, are more of like the outskirts where everyone's sort of like having little block parties. And, but the costumes are outrageous. They're really, really outrageous. It seemed like people were having a lot of fun, but on a personal level, it's really not my thing. It's just not my thing, but that doesn't discount the fact that everyone was enjoying themselves.
Mm-hmm. Josue, I take my state board exam tomorrow. My instructor said, do something relaxing the day before your exam. So here I am.
Oh, good.
That's awesome. I'm glad we're relaxing.
I'm glad we're relaxing.
I've never been told that before.
No.
I've been told I stress people out, but that's cool. I'm glad you're here, Josue. Aurora, a friend of mine who's well-versed in dog training with e-collar and prong, told me, seeing dogs sleeping in place with prong collars is questionable. I don't understand the problem.
I don't understand the problem either. Everybody's an expert, too. It's like, what's the big deal? What's going to happen? Is it going to stab the dog's neck? I mean, excuse me. No. I mean, there is a small risk with a dog in a crate with a unsupervised because it can get caught in the wires. But a dog sleeping on a dog mat with a prong collar on, I don't see the harm in it. I mean, people are assuming that a prong collar is constantly being activated just because it's on the dog. And that's the farthest thing from the truth. It just sits there and does nothing. It literally does nothing. It's when you activate the collar. Is it questionable? I think owning a dog in general is questionable. Anything could happen at any time, at any moment that, you know, anything can happen. Anytime you wake up in the morning, there's a risk of some sort of something happening. So well-versed, it's like five dog trainers are going to probably disagree or agree with that statement. Next.
Michelle, good evening, Jeff and Joelle. Happy to see you back and feeling better.
It is. It's. I'm looking forward to my full recovery. I'm gonna
can't wait to get to the gym.
I'm gonna try out the gym tomorrow and see if I can get back into my routine and we'll see how that goes.
Can't wait.
Yes.
Freaking ready. I'm not even gonna sleep tonight. It's like Christmas morning tomorrow. Emily, I wish I had 6 hours a day to train, but how much should I try to make sure I set aside for a 1-year-old working dog?
But you don't need 6 hours a day to train. I mean, you can. Who's that, Emily?
Yeah.
Emily, how much time do you have to train? That's how much time you have to train. That's the right answer. You know, and if you want to try to get a little bit more in, well, then look at the rest of your life and see if there's anything else you can cut back. But 6 hours of training, unless you're trying to get to competition level, I think it's a little bit excessive. Most people don't have 6 hours of train. Why? Because they have a life. I think you can turn a lot of training into a lifestyle, and I'm a pet dog trainer, so it's like my dogs have been in place in 4-hour increments today. I just let them out really quick to go to the bathroom right before the show. They ran twice really hard today to the point of like exhaustion, which was enough. I don't really run them through obedience commands anymore. I just live my life with my dog. So that's just the way it is. Next.
Chloe and Luca, Jeff and Joelle, I'm about to give up. Luca got out into the front yard and started fence fighting another dog. Didn't have his e-collar on because we were playing with the hose. I grabbed him by his scruff when he was in full attack mode and he bit me. I probably shouldn't have grabbed him, but he was literally going to go over the fence.
Correct.
This is the first time he has been out since I full-on blasted him the last time for fence fighting. What do I do?
So next time, I mean, it's not surprising that a dog in drive turns on its handler. That's just what dogs do. A lot of dogs will do that. They don't even realize they're doing it. Especially when they're fence fighting, especially, or they're doing fence fighting is a good one to turn on a handler, or, you know, leash reactivity. If you grab too close to the dog, that can easily happen. Most remote collars are waterproof. So I would just set it up again. And it sucks. It sucks. Dogs in drive do stupid, stupid things. Next.
Roxy, morning. Needing some tips to stop our dog digging huge holes in our backyard. Our paving is starting to fall due to his digging.
Well, that's a problem. So what you can do is you put a remote collar on a dog, and you'll hear a lot of recipes on how to stop digging. Like, fill it up with water. Great. That'll probably cause the driveway to collapse even quicker.
Fill it up with shit.
Fill it up with poop. And now you've got a dog that digs in poop. Fill it up with the dog's food. It's like, I don't want my dog eating out of holes in the backyard. Or put a remote collar on the dog, and you're inside the house, and the dog starts digging a hole, and you correct your dog at a very high level. You make it very uncomfortable to dig holes in the backyard. That's how you fix things. So when you hear people say, oh, Jeff uses pain to train, it's like, well, can we please scale that a little bit to stop an unwanted behavior such as digging a hole in the backyard? Yes, that's what I would do. Do we use pain to train a dog on how to do an obedience command? Absolutely, positively not. It's like all these people that are going around saying that, you know, Jeff hits dogs to train them. It's like, what are you, crazy? Like, let's all think about that rationally. Mm-hmm. Like, that is the most irrational statement that there is. No, I don't. None of my staff does. Do we throw a cotton towel at a dog to stop from lunging at another dog? Yeah, we do. And if you want to turn that into hitting a dog, man, that is on you 100%. But to think that I go around the world hitting dogs to train them is just shows people's lack of even common sense thinking. Mm-hmm. It just does. Like, I can get away with that. All these people are going to be sitting in the stands watching me just hit a dog to train a dog to do things. It doesn't work that way. Stopping an unwanted behavior, such as lunging at a dog, trying to bite a human, using a cotton towel or remote collar to stop it. Yes, absolutely. That's what you do. And if there's other ways to do it, is step one, I'd love to see it. As step one, I'd love to see it. That's not part of the counter conditioning process, but that's part of the step one. Next.
$5 top chat from Hannah. Hello, I am researching e-collars, and I know you use the educator products, but what are the advantages of that brand versus the Dogtra product?
Probably just personal taste. If you've got your heart set on Dogtra, get Dogtra. As far as, like, the stim patterns, are there different stim patterns to them? There are. Is one better than the other? I think it really boils down to personal choice. Next.
One big weirdo. Also, both of my dogs walked in a perfect heel, passing a dog barking its head off today.
Excellent.
They both used to be so leash reactive and have made so much progress. I'm so glad I found your videos.
Awesome. You know, one of the things, bless you, Angelo. You know, one of the things that we should, Angelo, bless you again. You know, one of the things we should really talk about also is, you know, a lot of owners, a lot of owners don't know where to start. So I just say start. And we had a couple at our Florida seminar who have a dog.
Sorry, I'm like rolling out of camera.
You're rolling out of camera view? Okay. Who had a dog who literally were like, they just had no control over their dog. Dog was a little bit to a lot overweight, and they didn't have any control over their dog at all, and their dog wouldn't even kennel up, and all of a sudden they just started. And they're on day four of a 90-day, we call it a 90-day rehab. And literally, they're getting their dog under control finally.
Yeah.
They're finally getting their dog under control. And what are they doing? They're doing the work. They're literally saying, enough of this fucking shit. We're not putting up with this nonsense anymore. We're going to do the bare minimum. And when I say bare minimum, that doesn't mean lazy. It means just like, you're going in your crate. You're going to lie down on place. You're going to walk this way. These are the tools we're going to be using. I'm going to cut down on affection. You are going to go lie down right there. I am going to do 10-minute drills of sit. And I am going to start demanding that you go to place. And I am going to start doing my down drills. And I am going to walk you a certain way. And I'm not going to allow you to sniff and wander all over the place on the walk. And you are going to sleep in a crate out of my bedroom. And all of a sudden, the dog just starts believing you. And goes, oh, wow, I actually have to listen. And in four days, they've finally are getting, like, they're seeing the results of it. They're seeing the results of it. And it's no different than everything we do here at our training center. When we can take an out of control dog that comes into the training center and they walk in the training center and all of a sudden, like, the same dog that was lunging at Angelo, walking by, Angelo can roll around on a scooter. And what did we do? We didn't do any miraculous thing other than massive structure. We absolutely stopped the bad behavior, which takes 1 to 3 seconds. Mm-hmm. How do we do that? Absolutely with a high level of a remote, absolutely with a bonker. But the real magic was the hundreds of repetitions of reinforcing the command, which, by the way, we use food for. So we clicker train and food train dogs here. But once we stop the unwanted behavior, that's not what you're doing. And I think a lot of people are missing step one. Mm-hmm. That's what, and I think that's why we get such a bad, or me personally, get such a bad reputation because of this, like, Jeff does this. It's like, yeah, because everybody wants me to stop stuff. But it's like, that's not the big picture. So I think once you start doing that, all of a sudden you get a handle on it, and all of a sudden your dog just goes, I'll just start listening. But then there's the association. The dog has to believe you, the owner, next.
I think a part of it too, though, and you always say this at your seminars, is like redirection and telling the dog to stop. It works in the moment, but if it's happening every day, moving forward, you're technically not stopping the behavior.
No.
But so many people see results in that moment, and it sounds nice to use food or redirection.
Oh, right.
But you're not really fixing the issue, though.
You have not put an inhibitor into the behavior.
Yeah.
Right. It'll just keep happening and happening and happening.
Yeah.
So it's easy to redirect. But then again, also, if you've got this amazing skill set that you can handle that dog like that every day, that's one thing. But your average dog owner can't.
Yeah.
So they need these tools. Next.
Dog has bit our vet before. Very sudden with no trigger. How do you regain that confidence again when working with your dog?
So there's always a trigger. Going to the vet alone is a trigger. Dogs hate vets. So number one, I muzzle half my dogs at the vet, and then I control all my dogs' heads at the vet. I think your dog should learn how to be muzzle trained. Vets are usually pretty smart about that stuff. So usually a dog does not like stuff shoved up its ass or being handled by a stranger or its tail lifted up or have its ears checked or mouth checked. Some dogs don't mind, but think about it. Think about you as an owner. Like every time you put eardrops in Wes, he growls a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
He hates it.
One
of my dogs absolutely moves away and I tell him to cut the shit. But if it wasn't me, he probably would growl at the person and try to snap at them.
Mm-hmm.
So I think by muzzling up the dog and just holding the dog's head there and saying, tough shit, we have to look in your ears. Or I've got to look in your mouth, which is hard to do with a muzzle on. So how do you regain the trust is you role play it over and over and over again. I really, really wish people started looking at their dogs like animals, like the animals that they are. And dogs respond to dangerous behaviors with historically well-planned out, established protocols, which will stop those behaviors. So you can role play it by muzzling up your dog at the vet and then going. But also, a dog's behavior at the vet does not, what's the word I'm looking for, define the overall behavior of the dog. You know, I have a dog that hates going on the scale and the stainless steel table that goes up and down. Hates mm-hmm. it. Hates it. But doesn't have a problem with a lot of other things. Next.
Yep. Kibu, hello, Jeff and Joelle. Hope you're feeling better.
Thank you so much,
Thank
Kibu.
You. Chloe and Luca, I already read that. Ken, do you have a video of rules, guidelines for structured play for a small group of dogs, almost like a daycare?
I don't know. We don't have anything written down. We're not big on, we're not your typical daycare that just allows dogs to run around and play freely. Usually what happens is when dogs get too adrenalized, what they do is they make stupid choices. So I think one of the things is, I think that's where I don't know your skill set reading dogs. I don't know your skill set at identifying triggers of a potential fight. I think that's where you're going to have to, I'm not one to tell you how to run your pack of dogs. With my personal dogs, I let them play really hard. But with the dogs here at the training center, that we deal with a lot of dogs that don't play well together, what we do is we usually keep it very neutral and they just mill about. They mill about. Next.
Chloe and Luca, I already read that too. It's all broken up. Gerardo, before anyone asks how to train a protection dog, if their dog doesn't listen to them or no basic obedience, that should be the last thing on their mind.
I don't do protection work at all, so I'm not qualified to even make a comment about the protections part of it. But I would think that if you were going to train your dog a higher level task that would involve using its mouth, I would think you'd want to have a good not only control over your dog, but a good relationship over your dog. Next.
That's life. My service dog was attacked by a French bulldog and is now reactive toward toward any bully breed. Help.
So I think what happens is that happens a lot.
All the time.
And it's not just from an attack. I think some dogs just start getting leash reactive. Mm-hmm. They just go through a stage of their life where it's like, I think I'm going to lash out at dogs now. Mm-hmm. It just happens.
Yeah.
Like that great Pyrenees in the video that has gotten me so much shit. It just all of a sudden started getting leash reactive. But so many dogs get, not just service dogs, but so many dogs that are minding their own business, walking with their owners, all of a sudden 1 to 3 dogs attack it out of the blue. Well, what do you think is going to happen moving forward? When it sees other dogs, it's going to lunge at them to keep them away. So what do? You, as the human advocate, and you make sure you get really good at keeping dogs away. How do you do that? Bear spray, hiking stick, your body, your voice, your feet. And then you also start training your dog that it can be around dogs and no one is going to get to it. And that takes, you know, it might take a couple of good corrections to stop your dog from doing it. But it's a very, very, very big problem. And I think everybody needs to learn a skill set from that. And I think a lot of people who sit back and poo-poo some of the stuff we do should be paying attention, because it possibly might happen to you one day and you might have to deal with it. And I think a lot of people that have not been walking in the footsteps of our clients, it's easy to pass judgment and it's easy to cast a negative statement or a vicious statement our way. But it's like, number one, you actually might already be in that same boat as us. Like, we have people that, like, they don't even have control over their dogs, let alone you might be in that situation one day. So open your eyes and pay attention. Next.
Rachel, hey, this is my first time ever watching a YouTube live. Glad my first is y'all. I've been listening to the replays, so this is really cool to be a part of it live.
Awesome, Rachel. Yeah.
Welcome. Kyle. My GSD is now 13 months old and has been excellent so far. Last week, he was seriously ill with vomiting and diarrhea. Had to spend some time overnight in the vet, plus days of needles and me forcing
medicine.
It's all broken up. Yep. I'm trying to find it. Now when people touch his head, he pins his ears back and is a bit nervous.
Yeah. Don't worry about that. What you can do is, the pinning of the ears back, so many people overread body language. Like, when I go in to pet my dogs, their ears go back. They're not afraid of me. They're just, I don't know, maybe it's the most aerodynamic way to get a pet.
Yeah, Wes does too, and he like squints his eyes.
Yeah, I don't think that they're like, now, could your dog be flinching? It might be. So what do you do? I'm just thinking of girl in particular. Her ears always go back when I go to pet her. But then again, when she's running towards me, her ears go back too.
Yeah, when they're running full speed, they are very like aerodynamic. Right.
So what do you do? You could always do clicker and food protocol, where you've got your clip. Make sure you train your dog what a clicker means. And then you have food. You go to touch your dog's head. Click food, click food, click food. And the dog goes, oh, touching of the head is a good thing. You can do that, or don't even worry about it.
Yeah.
Next.
Eric. Melissa posted the link to the seminars.
Oh, thank
Eric says, Jeff, do you use any kind of food reward or just verbal?
No, we use the dog's daily kibble here.
Tons of food.
Tons. We use the dog's daily food to train all our basic obedience and to counter condition every dog on our property if they have food drive. If they don't have food drive, there's nothing you can do. And I think that's why every dog trainer out there or every dog owner should have a skill set for what happens when the dog doesn't have food, doesn't have drive. And you don't have to use food to train a dog, but because some dogs won't take food. Some dogs won't take a toy. You can't even pet the dog because it tries to bite you. So, but yes, we use food.
Balanced Pet Canine Training. Hey, Jeff and Joelle. Ren here. So excited you guys are coming to Portland. See you there.
Yes, it should be a fun trip.
Kyle. Already read that. Lou, welcome back. Missed you lots. Had to email to make sure you hadn't been banned in New Zealand. Was so worried. Maddie was lovely and emailed back.
No, we're not banned anywhere.
No.
It's really, we're not banned anywhere. Yeah.
Canadian girl. So very glad you guys are better. I missed you guys. Yep. Thanks, Canadian
I think some
girl.
Of our shows might not show up somewhere because I swear a lot in it.
Maybe.
Yeah, that I've seen before. Yeah. But that's like just a YouTube thing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Too vulgar.
Yep.
Hillary, we are doing super well with starting e-collar training on our six-month-old doodle pup. Staying place super, super well, but I'm wondering how we can work on an auto down when he's on his place.
So start teaching down off of place and then make it part of place. And then it's place is not done until the dog is in down. It becomes pretty seamless, actually. So place will end up being place and then down. But you do that in two separate training protocols. Train place, train place, train place. A lot of times the dogs default to a down. Train down off of place. You put them together and then pretty much you just do place, down, place, down, place, down. And then when the dog goes on a place and it doesn't down, eventually you'll tell it that it's wrong and you'll guide the dog down there. And eventually you tell the dog what they did would be no. And that's after hundreds of repetitions. It's just all repetitive. Just put the reps in. Next.
Oh, you didn't say it.
Oh.
Chloe and Luca, dog bites hurt. I almost passed out. No blood, but my arm is already black and blue, and this happened 10 minutes ago.
Say that one more time.
Chloe and Luca, her dog bit her.
Why?
For fence fighting.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, it's hard. Yeah, I mean, it's easy to be, I'm sorry that it happened. It's called redirection. I mean, if whoever would have been standing there probably would have gotten bit. Grabbing the dog, if it had no collar on, and grabbing it and doing it. That's why having equipment on the dog definitely helps, or a leash on the dog that you can pull your dog back. Even we're always surprised when our dogs will put their mouth on us. Now, some people say, oh, my dog would never bite me. Well, until it does. That doesn't mean your dog's going to like just run up to you and attack you. But when dogs are fence fighting, they're not thinking straight. Mm-hmm. It's like you're
drunk.
It's like your friend being drunk, taking a swing at you. Like, I highly doubt your dog would just walk up. Your friend would walk up to him, just punch you in the face. But when it's drunk and you're trying to get it out of a bar and you're grabbing it, it's probably going to just start hitting things and you might be in the way. Next.
Good analogy. I love my pit bull Peaches. Says, hey, all.
Hey.
Mothman, I'm glad y'all are putting your well-being first. I think I'm going to like the new schedule and the lighting looks great.
Oh, thanks. Coincidentally, we didn't have good internet either. I think if we were in Providence and sick, we still might have tried to squeeze out at least one of the shows.
I just think he means by the time, like, because we're doing it earlier. So we can, like, semi-shorter days.
Got it. Yeah. Well, thank you for the compliment. Mm-hmm. That's true. I think we're both.
I need my sleep. My age is showing.
I think, yeah, you're all of 25 now. So I think we're doing that in general a lot more.
Yeah. Raymond or Ramon, I'm not sure. How to deal with ball aggression with my 5-month Malinois.
Well, ball aggression, you should teach the dog the out command. The out command teaches the dog to drop whatever it's in its mouth or move away from something. So if you've got a 5-month-old Mal, Mals are intense dogs. I usually don't stereotype dogs. I don't want to say the word stereotype, but categorize dogs. But I think if you've got a Mal, you definitely should be working with a trainer that works with working dogs because it's a special kind of dog. Next.
Angela, do y'all notice a lot of aha moments where it just clicks for the dog? I see this with my worst cases, but is this common?
I think it is. Mm-hmm. I think a lot of dogs, whenever they connect the dots,
that breakthrough is
we
beautiful.
See that a lot. And I think we see it a lot with owners too.
Becky Lou. Hey guys, I want to know if we are raw feeders, if we should find a kibble suitable for a lengthy quarantine due to the virus, COVID-19.
So I'm not familiar with that virus at all. I mean, medical stuff I'm not familiar with. But I think, I mean, my dogs do terrible on kibble. They shit up a storm. But I guess if your dog is quarantined and it has to be like off-site quarantine, I highly doubt they're going to do raw. They do make prepared raw. Maybe they'll accommodate you there. I would just say I'm the last guy to talk to about food. So you might want to consult like an online food directory on that one.
Rachel, I applied for the internship and was so excited when Jeff called. I know it was not a yes, but hopefully it wasn't a no. I was so nervous, excited on the phone. I hope I didn't blow it. Fingers crossed.
Rachel, you totally blew it, and I can't stand you, and I never want to talk to you again. I think, Rachel, I said you'll be fine. Don't worry. I'll call. I've been away for a week, but I'll be giving you a call soon. Next.
Bizarre. Hello, guys. If I think I made some mistakes with e-collar training my five-month-old puppy, should I take a break or what? Welcome back.
I think, Fazad, what you can do is you can be like, recognize what your mistakes are. And we all make mistakes in life, on every category of our life, and not just on dog training. And I think just recognize those and readjust, start from scratch, take it slower, start one command at a time, use a lot of food, make sure your levels are lower for all your basic stuff. And I think you'll do okay.
Christina, hey J&J, thanks for the DIY spatial pressure video. Game changer. 2 days of driveway drills with that, and he's a new dog. Thank you. We even tried a walk nicely board and train with no success.
Yes. Woohoo! So good for you. And we're doing down this week.
We got to do all the commands.
Yeah, but down, I think, is the next one we're going to be doing.
I think we should. Sure, let's do down.
You run the show. You tell me. That makes the most sense.
Do we really need to do one on sit? You think people need to know? I think it's good just maybe for people to understand, like, pressure on, pressure
I think
off.
They, believe it or not, there are people out there that are struggling with teaching their dogs how to sit. Yes.
So let's do, like, sit down, recall.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay, next.
Jackie. Hi, Jeff and Joelle. Hi from Lyons, Colorado. My issue is my dog wants to hump other dogs. I do have an e-collar, which I do use. Thank you. Jackie.
So, Jackie, we use actually a stockyard whip, and we smack that on the dog's butt. Humping is really dangerous. It could turn into a fight. But you can try a remote collar. If your dog is savvy on the remote, I would feel comfortable with it. But I don't know your dog. But a little stockyard whip to the butt, it's like, yes, you actually smack the dog on the butt when it tries to hump another dog that historically has the humping dog run away. Next.
Mothman, if a dog is suffering from separation anxiety, what is the minimum amount of affection you should be giving to help with the relationship?
It's got separation anxiety?
Yeah.
So I think with separation anxiety, I don't know the level of it, but usually most people, if I said cut it off 100%, you wouldn't listen to me. So I'll tell you to cut it off 100%, and then whatever you do is probably going to be the acceptable amount. I think you should just be more conscious of it, and if also start creating space. A lot of people are like, my dog is great when I'm in the room, but when I leave, it's not great. I'm like, I know, that's called separation anxiety. And so many dogs struggle with it to the point where they massively destroy crates, jump out of windows, self-mutilate. Somebody's sleeping and whining over there.
Is that what that is?
Yeah, it's like a whistle.
In their sleep, yeah.
Yeah, it's a whistle, yeah. Next.
Somebody's gassing it up in here, though. It's so bad. Oh, my God.
My nose is a little bit stuffy, but yeah, that's usually your dogs that do that.
They didn't eat anything unusual today.
Angelo, is that you?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's Angelo.
Is it Angelo?
Yeah.
I
thought you meant the noise I just made.
No, are you farting?
No.
Oh, okay.
Oh, my God. It's so bad. Adnan. Oh, wait. Hold on. I skipped one. A. Bataglia. Hi, J&J. Advice on training out from the handler. Lucy is awesome at out, like drop it and out from other people or dogs. But when I try out from me, she downs or sits. Please help.
The dog doesn't... Wait.
Out, like going away.
Oh, so you have to teach... Again, out is a taught protocol. You have to role play it. We have a video on that, don't we? Yeah, we have a video on that.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure she was at the seminar that we did it, but she's having trouble with only her. Like, she'll do it from other people, but not her, the handler.
So what I would do is I would do a higher level momentary stim to see if that works. Next.
And have somebody else with a leash to get her away from you,
right,
too.
Have somebody guide it away.
Might just be a new picture for her. Yeah. Adnan, hi Solid Canine, thank you for everything you do. We love you. We have a male 5-year-old Staffy. He gets excited very easily, and when he does, he grabs a leash with his mouth and starts tugging. We lose all control. This also happens when we grab the leash to correct him. What do we do?
So your dog is pretty smart and knows there's a correction coming. That's where a bonker works really, really great. dogs will often grab leashes because they know that it's connected to them, and they know that the leash is also connected to you, and they'll grab it because then now all of a sudden you're playing tug of war with the dog. So the bonker no, and then bonk works really, really great. And if you don't know what a bonker is, watch my videos on how to make it and how to use it. Next.
Erica, much love and healing to you both. Thank you for all you do, and so looking forward to Frederick.
Yeah, Frederick is always a fun one, and so are we.
Aurora, I was interviewed to be a private contractor trainer for a training company here in Ohio. They want $10,000 to train me for 4 weeks, just the basics. $50,000 for extensive training for PPD training, too.
They want you to pay that?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I don't know the company. I'm not going to tell someone how to run their business or take, you know, money out of their pocket at all. But I think, do your due diligence, and also, you know, how are you going to make that money back? I think it's almost like college tuition. You know, what happens after that? Like, what happens after that? Next.
Deb, good evening, and thanks so much for the Florida seminar. Cold but great weekend. Deb and Armani, the pushy snotty Basenji, LOL.
Yeah, Deb, you crack down on that dog and you start holding that dog accountable. You'll start, and don't put up, you should have that I'm not putting up with your bullshit anymore attitude, and you'll do fine.
Mm-hmm. It was nice meeting you, Deb.
And it was really nice to meet you, Deb.
Aurora, I'm considering this position, but the financial is the problem. 7 a.m. to 7 p.m. with no income is hard for myself as a barista.
Yeah, I think then that's, you know, you've got to just see if you can do an internship somewhere, maybe. Next.
Holding on dog training. Happy to see you both. Here to learn more. Love y'all. Love you, Ashley.
Love you, Ashley. Angelo, yeah. Keep it down.
Who's he talking to?
To himself. He's learning over there. Angelo's got a podcast tomorrow night at 5:30 p.m., by the way, on this channel. Next.
Gretchen, Stone's downstays are a problem. He shuffles, not like readjusting out of discomfort, more like he can barely hold it in him to stay where he's at, despite teaching place. And I'm trying to teach double down. He can't calm down for anything. He seems to have a hard time accepting nothing in boredom.
So I think you might have to just do more repetitions, but also correct. So a lot of people, what they do is once you start doing your reps, you get into a couple hundred reps of doing down, then it's time to start saying no and correct. And your dog is probably overly aroused. And that's usually what happens. And once they start getting that one or two correction for breaking a down, they go, oh, this is what you want in them. They just don't know. They just don't know. I think a lot of people also keep their dogs in a heightened state of arousal, and they do that through over-talking to their dogs. Like, over-talking to their dogs, over-handling their dogs, and they just don't leave their damn dogs alone. For some reason, some people have a hard time just like there's five dogs in here now doing nothing. And I assure you, the majority of people that walked in this room, they'd all want to come over and touch these dogs. And it's like, can't you just leave the dogs alone? And that doesn't mean you shouldn't touch your dog. I'm not saying that. But what I'm saying is, like, all the dogs are just being quiet. Leave them alone. Leave them alone. So I think that might be it with you. It might not be. Next.
Sarah Bugart. Hey, everyone. So glad you guys are feeling better, J&J.
Thank you so much.
Hannah. Hello. I'm researching e-collars, and I know you use the educator. Oh, she made that a top tie. I already read it. Gretchen. I already read that. Aurora. I met the owner of the company and watched the trainers in action, and it seemed amazing. I get to work from home with this. What are your thoughts on joining something like this?
I again, it's all personal choice. I don't know where you are in your life. I don't know where your budget is. I don't know what your master plan is. Again, all I know is that it's like, are they going to give you work afterwards? I really can't tell you what to do. I just can't. I'm not going to tell somebody what to do with their life like that. Next.
Gretchen, he'll chase, bite his tail when I'm not doing anything with him. So I started correcting him for that, and it's been better, but he still hasn't started to calm down around anything outside. Dead silence. With the prong collar, he shakes constantly with it on. I'd be okay with once or twice, but it's very excessive, and I tried pops, and he keeps doing it.
What's he doing? Shaking?
Just, like, constantly, like, readjusting, like, he won't settle.
Oh, for the downstay. your dog just might be overly aroused. I mean, I would just pattern it and pattern it and pattern it. And a lot of people's corrections are not real corrections. They're like nagging, and he just might need a really good correction. And then also, what's the rest of the day look like? Can you keep your dog in a calm state at different times of the day? Or is your dog always in the state of arousal? Next.
Chloe and Luca, going back to my story, in the future, to prevent being bit, say he didn't have his D-collar on, what should I have done instead of grabbing him?
Well, I mean, you have limited choices. You have limited choices, right? So you need to stop the fence fighting somehow. So you can grab a leash and wrap the leash around him and pull him away. But you're in a hard position. I would just set it up again. I'd set it up with his remote collar on. Next.
Aurora, with training to get better experience, should I work only with dogs that I know the owner will follow up on training with? I have a dog I'm house-sitting for 10 days. Owner said I can work with him. He barks out the windows and bouncing off the walls. I was going to make barking out windows suck with e-collar and teach place.
Yes. Yeah, I think at the beginning of your career, you want to work with as many dogs as possible, whether the owners follow through with it or not, just to get your experience. Eventually, you want to work with owners who are going to follow through. But what it boils down to is our job, yes, you want to build your skill set, but they're not our dogs. They're the owner's dogs. So if we teach the dog what we want them to do, stop the unwanted behavior, pass on the information to the owners, coach the owners on what to do, guide them and coach them and lead them, then it's on them. And then it's on them. And if they don't want to follow through, that's on them. So if you tell, I'll make it really simple. If you tell an owner, I think you should be crating your dog so it doesn't destroy your leather couch when you leave the house. And if they refuse to crate the dog and the dog destroys their couch and they come back and they yell at you, it's like, I'm the one that told you to crate your dog. Like, I told you how to stop it. Now, is that the only way to stop it? No, but I think it's the most practical way. Next.
Hillary, also, once you mentioned your dog, Uma, I think, who had a great recall, but she went for a deer.
Yep.
You said you changed how you trained the recall. What did you change, and how do you train it now?
What I did was, she had incredible recall, and she blew through the highest setting on a dog train 1900. She had incredible recall, but that day, she got into such high drive, and she saw a deer, and she didn't care about any of the training at all. And I think if you talk to just about any dog trainer, they blow off commands. And if anybody disagrees with that, just go onto YouTube and search dog obedience competition fails, and you'll see the best of the best make mistakes. And Uma was just my pet dog. What I did was I corrected her high for recall before she went into drive. And I did that like once or twice. So now she's like became hyper aware. I mean, she's dead now, but she became hyper aware of the recall, and it never happened again. Next.
One big weirdo. I came across a hate video of you today, and it's a shame that people are spreading a video out of context. People are so quick to jump on the hate and bandwagon without further research.
Yeah, we get that a lot. I mean, it's still being spread. It's the bonking video. There's like one or two of them out there. And they all originated from my content, and the original content is still up with a full explanation of what I did, why I do it. And these are owners whose dogs are either leash reactive or leash reactive towards a bicycle. And everybody can have an opinion on how to fix it, but I think people are missing the overall point that the problem was fixed. That's what I was hired to do with full permission of the owner. And I think for people to turn this, like, bonking a dog that's going after other dogs into, like, some sort of abuse, and then to turn it into this humongous effort to keep me from coming into, you know, a certain area to do a seminar, I think it's just sad. I think it's all part of the cancel culture. And I think for other trainers to jump on board, I think it's a little bit dangerous, too, because whether you like me or not, or you agree with my methods or not, it could happen to you. And it's going to happen to you. And it is happening to you. And that's what people do. They get one piece of information and they run with it without even doing any research whatsoever. So it's just that's the downfall of social media. The downfall of social media. Next.
PM, any tips for a dog in heat while living with a male dog? They already sleep in different rooms.
All depends on whether your dog cares or not. I mean, I would be really, really cautious. I think you definitely would want to make sure you've got really good separation, especially if the male is intact. If the male is intact, so you don't have an accidental litter. Next.
CT Vader, hey guys, welcome back. How do you know what's puppy behavior or bad behavior? By the way, love the 7 o'clock start time.
Oh, awesome. Thank you. So I think I'm enjoying it too. Hold on. Angel, you all set, buddy?
Yeah.
Okay. So I think that... what's the behavior? I don't think he said what the behavior was.
Puppy behavior or bad behavior? Yeah,
I need something a little bit more specific.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it depends on the age of the puppy, too.
Right. What's a puppy? Some people think a 12-month-old, 14-month-old dog is still a puppy.
Eric, my dog has recently come back from a trainer that trains very similar to the way you do. My dog's working level is an 8. What do you recommend as far as an emergency number for getting in the trash, etc.?
Well, I don't think it would be more of an emergency number, and I don't think it'd be a certain number. Okay, getting in the trash, the number you used for getting in the trash has got nothing to do with the working level. So working level numbers have nothing to do with correction level numbers when it comes to stopping unwanted behaviors. When it comes to obedience, that's a different story, but let's talk about stopping unwanted behaviors. To me, I tend to use the highest number possible for getting in the trash. Why do I do that? I do that because your dog could die. It's as simple as that. If your dog got in the trash and ate a cooked bone or like, you know, a half a chicken bone or a quarter chicken bone or a chicken leg or, you know, some food that was poisonous to the dog, your dog could die or it could cost you thousands of dollars. So for me, giving that dog 1 to 3 seconds of intolerable discomfort for doing that, it's worth it. Next.
Sarah Bug R, I had a couple people over after a while on dreading it. Had Kanai in place and corrected using prong to loading and barking. He was calm and fell asleep. I released him when he woke up and he was very different. Super calm, super different mindset. I let him go to the guests and he loved the attention.
Good. Sounds like that worked out perfect. Next.
She-Wolf, good evening, J&J. Sending love your way.
Thank you so much.
I have a rescue GSD pup who is a crybaby, never has a leash or a collar on, and little to no human interaction. He cries bloody murder with any pressure with the leash and the bonker. Very depends on his brother, so we keep them separated.
Yes.
What can we do to stop the reactive crying?
So that's a hard one, and I'll tell you why. Because we get those dogs in that any leash pressure on those dogs, they freak out. And unless you've ever experienced it, you have no idea what it looks like or sounds like. And it is horrific.
Horrific.
It is like you're killing that dog for just the littlest amount of leash pressure. That is not one thing you do. That is like that's what we do here in boarding train. We get dogs. What do? We work them through it. And we let them scream, and we keep working them, and we let them know they're screaming, which is an objection. You're not hurting the dog. Oh, you must be hurting the dog. That's why it's screaming. No. Dogs, if you were hurting the dog, yes, it might be screaming. But the dogs that I'm talking about are dogs at the slightest amount of leash pressure scream like you were killing it. It's like it doesn't scale. It's like you can't have candy, young man, and there's the biggest temper tantrum in the world compared to that. So what do? You keep working the dog through all the screaming and you let the dog know, listen, I'm not going to stop because you're screaming. And that tends, the dog goes, oh, so the screaming doesn't work. And it's just an objection. And it's just an objection, but it's so unbearable to listen to sometimes. It doesn't happen overnight. A lot of times it is a progress. It's a work in progress. Mm-hmm. And you will get dogs like that. We see dogs like that. And sometimes it takes a week. Sometimes it takes 10 days for them to get over it. But when you start going like, listen, I'm not going to stop because of your objections. Next.
Aurora, completely agree with treating dogs like animals. I've worked with livestock, horses, dogs, Treating animals like animals is the only way to have a real relationship with them. They are not kids.
They're not even close to kids. They are different species, and it's disrespectful to actually compare the two. And whenever anybody does that, it just shows your lack of intelligence. I said, when anybody ever says, oh, would you ever put a remote collar on your kid? That's a really stupid statement. I will go as far as saying that. It is a stupid statement. Of course I would not do that. I'm sure there's plenty of parents out there that would like to, and that doesn't mean they want to abuse their kids, but it's like, but as a parent and as a dog owner, I think it's a ridiculous fucking comparison. It's like, no, it's like you're a child and at a certain age I can have a rational conversation with you, but it's like, no, you're a dog and you're an animal. And right now, or a lot of the times, we can't have a reasonable conversation. So I have to tell you what I want you to do and what I don't want you to do. But it's just always incredible how people are willing to put up with a unwanted behavior, even though they know they can stop it, but they won't do it because it doesn't. They would never do that to their kid. Mm-hmm. But it's like, but you're talking about a dog. And just because whenever you say it's a dog, like I use that statement all the time, it's just a dog, that doesn't mean you should treat it badly, but it just means it's a dog.
It's a different species.
It's like my dogs ride in the back of my truck. My kids sit in car seats or in seats with seatbelts in them. Mm-hmm. Like my children, you know, don't run around barefoot outside in the wintertime. They don't eat on the floor out of bowls. Right. You know, when they get their thermometer, you know, their temperature taken, I just like go like this with that little thermometer thing. You know what I mean? So it's like, I think people need to realize that it's like,
their kids don't eat raw meat.
My kids don't eat raw meat either. So, you know, I mean, I think it's a ridiculous comparison. And I think that's one of the downfalls we're having is that we've humanized our animals to the point where we're living through this shit show of bad behaviors of dogs.
We're doing them a disservice, yep. Honestly. Chloe and Luca, for a dog that knows the command, how many times do you say it before you correct them with the e-collar? I'm wondering if that is why Luca isn't listening, because sometimes I tell him 3 to 4 times before I correct.
I think if you cut that down in half to 1 or 2 times, I think you'll start speeding up your obedience.
Ashley, Jeff, what do you think about the pit bull ban? I'm so curious.
Well, I don't think there should be really bans of any breeds. I think a dog's, if you're going to ban something, you should ban it on the behavior of something, not the breed of something. I think it's really, really dangerous to ban a whole breed I think it's really, really dangerous to do. I think it's really, really dangerous to ban tools. I think it's dangerous to get government involved in a lot of stuff. Just because something is used improper, or just because there are a couple of dogs out there or that might display a certain behavior. I mean, we see dangerous golden retrievers. We see Deb's on the show. She had a dog that's a Basenji that like growled and tried to bite every dog that was there. Should we ban Basenjis? Like, her dog tried to bite more of the dogs that were there than anyone else's. And this is not dissing Deb, but I'm just saying, should we all of a sudden bite Basenjis because we watched that dog and its behavior?
Right.
And meanwhile, we had the mushiest pit bulls there. So I think that, you know, it's really, really, there are groups out there, because they show up on my page often.
Oh my God.
Who are like, you know, every pit bull should be killed. And it's like, that's what they think. And they're entitled to their opinion, but it's like, okay, that's an interesting ideology. And that's what it is. It's an ideology. So I'm not a big fan of breed bans. Next.
You're really delaying the next tonight. It's like throwing me off.
Oh, sorry.
Sometimes you're too quick. And now tonight you're being like, there's a pause. And then next, I'm like, do I read it or not?
Oh, I see. So should I speed up my next?
No, I mean, you do whatever you want, Jeff. Aurora, what are some tips or drills for getting better focus on the handler? My dog knows her commands very well, but she's just always air scenting and looking around, even on a shorter leash.
I would just quicken everything up. I would just do a bunch of like quick 180 turns, some quick sits, some quick downs, turn into your dog, turn away from your dog, don't let your dog just, your dog's taking everything a little bit casually. I have a feeling. Next.
Francis, hi J&J. Can't wait to meet you both at your seminar in 2 weeks.
Oh, good. We'll see you in Seattle.
Seattle?
I mean, did I say Seattle? Frederick. I don't know what I said.
Seattle. Where's your brain tonight?
Kyle. It's frying.
Thanks, guys. I'm probably looking too much into it. He's always been so perfect. This is just a little thing I've noticed has changed since last week of him being unwell. He's much better now. It was Giardia he had and had really taken bad to it.
Yeah, Giardia sucks, you know? So I think we have to be careful about, like, we want these dogs to be, like, these perfect behavior and, like, dogs fuck up all the time, even the best dogs. So that's the way it is.
Chloe and Luca, what level on the e-collar do you correct with in a low stimulation environment, say for not sitting, high or low?
I'm not going to tell you what number because it all depends on the dog that's in front of me. And I think for any trainer to give you a number, it's like, how would they know? Number one, I don't even know your dog's working number. Number two, I don't know the environmentals. Number three, I don't know how many repetitions you've done it. So I have no idea. I don't know what the contact is that the collar is on the dog's neck. If the dog was in front of me and I worked the dog, I would say, today, right here, right now, this is the number that we used. I do that in my seminars. Mm-hmm. But just because I'm using a certain level at a seminar, that doesn't mean it's going to be the same level at home or the same level with, like, one more dog in the picture or with the wind blowing. You know what I mean? So it's like, don't worry about the number. Pay attention to the dog. Next.
Yeah. That's a good one. Kyle, I muzzled him for the vet, but no matter what they did to him, he never once reacted aggressively. They commented on him being a soft German shepherd.
Say that one more time.
Kyle's dog was a peach at the vet.
Oh.
Pay attention.
Open
your ears. You got peanut butter in them.
I wish. I'm hungry. Next.
Did you eat dinner?
Not yet.
Aye. Miss Druma, tried a prong on my 7-month-old Great Pyrenees. I feel like I already know where this is going. For the first time today, and she completely lost her mind for more than 10 minutes. Do I just keep putting it on her every day for a short period?
So, I mean, just to let you know, the prong collar did not hurt your dog. They just don't. I'm not seeing prong collars hurt dogs. I'm seeing dogs object to collars, not just prong collars, but collars in general. Chances are your Great Pyrenees has been able to just take you where it's wanted to go. And for the first time, your Great Pyrenees probably realized that it couldn't do that and probably just had a temper tantrum.
I hate to group dogs, but every peer we get in here for training does the same thing. When you put any leash pressure, they're like, I can't just pull you around anymore.
So I think that they were doing that. Your dog was doing that. So I would stick with it. Next.
Gerardo, positive only trainers want to ban tools that can charge thousands of dollars from owners that don't know any better. I met a couple that spent over $1,000 for no results. I spent $60 to train my dog.
Yeah, we just had a dog leave here that the owner spent $20,000 on no results. And it's like, it's no fault of her. Well, it's no fault of hers, but it's like, it's just so funny how people will go to so many different trainers and get, like, no results, and then they'll use the excuse that it's the dog when it might have been the training methodology, and most likely was the training methodology.
Yeah.
And sure, certain things work in certain classrooms, but I think a lot of trainers fail to address, number one, the proper tools, the proper training philosophy, then the training of the human as well. I think there's a lot of variables that are missing out there in dog training world. Next.
Gretchen, Rachel, you're already off to a great start with the internship. I applied weeks ago and Jeff didn't even text. I see how it is. I
think we've gotten back to you before, Gretchen. Next.
Yuri, what is the difference between chrome plated and steel prong collar?
Different metals, right? So,
they look different.
Steel plated.
Chrome plated and steel.
Well, one of them is going to be, some of them dogs respond differently if they have allergies to them. Mm. Which one I don't know about. Oh my God, excuse me. Next.
Sid, hi guys, welcome back. GSD is jealous when I handle other dogs. I use the out command and she still looks. Do I correct watching, not loading? Correct looks away, but watches again.
I mean, what's the dog's intent? I mean, I think the biggest thing is like, is a dog like staring like with intent to do something stupid? Or is it just, a lot of it is just based on intent. If you said out one more time and then move the dog away so it didn't care anymore, that would definitely be helpful. Next.
Aurora, can two dogs be on the same bed for place? We have two Danes that lay on both beds together occasionally. They take up so much room.
Sure.
As long as they're laying down in one spot and don't get up.
Yeah, why not?
Gretchen, Jeff, did you hear that? Pennsylvania recently banned leaving your dog out for longer than 30 minutes when it's 32 or less or 90 plus out.
No, I didn't, but I know that a lot of different states or cities they're banning leaving dogs unattended, and I understand why they're doing it. I mean, I understand why cities and states are putting up these laws and trying to pass these laws, and I understand why they're doing it all under the guise of animal cruelty. I really do. I just don't think a lot of them are very well thought out. You're trying to say that you cannot leave your dog. I mean, there are so many breeds of dogs that 32 degrees is nothing. That means if it was 30 degrees out, your long-haired Akita or your German Shepherd can't be lying down on the snow. Like, I prefer it. Yeah, there are so many dogs out there that actually would love to spend all day out there. Unattended? What does unattended mean? Well, if you have a fenced-in backyard, you're trying to say that I can't leave my dog outside to play with its sibling for 45 minutes? That just doesn't make sense to me. I think what they're doing is, the guise of it was, don't leave your dog out there for 24 hours at a time. Mm-hmm. I think that's what it boils down to. It's like, well, I think you need to be a little bit more specific in your laws if you're going to pass them. And then above 90 degrees, I mean, there are dogs out there like that are, if there's, does it take into factor shade? Does it take into
water?
I mean, if you've got ample shade and ample water, 90 degrees is not that hot in a lot of areas. I mean, it's like the norm in like lots of different parts of the country. Does it take into effect humidity? Does it take into effect breed of dog? So I just think it's, when you make these blanket rules, I think it's just really, really dangerous. And all it's going to do is, and then you've got to figure, whenever they pass a law, the first question you should always ask is, who pays for it? Who's going to enforce it? Who's going to pay for these enforcement officials? And then what are they going to do? Ticket people? And then what are those people going to do? Pay it? How about if they can't pay it? Now what are you going to do? What are you going to seize somebody's dog?
Take their dog away, put them in the shelter?
Put them in a shelter and another dog ends up in a shelter? I think you need to start like thinking about like the repercussions of these laws, but people like to vote on them because, yeah, that sounds like that would be too cruel for a dog. I mean, I get why they're doing it. I just don't think a lot of well thought out stuff is going behind it. Next.
Remman, hello, I'm using the recommended prong collar and have it fitted properly. My dog just lays on the ground biting on the leash and does not want to get up and walk. She only does this when the prong is on.
So I think your dog is just objecting. Again, it's a lot easier for people to say, oh, it's the prong that hurts the dog. But I'm telling you now, I've never seen one. Has a prong ever hurt a dog? I'm sure it has. But just like every other collar out there has hurt a dog, I'm sure those have too. But your dog is probably just objecting to it. And we see that here a lot. I shouldn't say a lot. With the amount of dogs that we work with here, though, it's not unusual for the first day for a dog to object to anything. And what do? Just work them through it. Just work them through it.
Kyle said COVID-19 is the coronavirus.
Oh, it just lets you know how stupid I am. So, wow. Well, if you're in an area where... Are you in an area where they even, that's going to be an issue? If you are, I don't know what to tell you on that one. I don't know what the law is going to be about separating your dog from the owner. Next.
Rye bread. My 1-year-old has a deep bark, yet a high-pitched cry at walks. No crying at home. Cries in the car. I wonder if he's car sick.
Could be. I mean, could be. It could be an arousal issue. It could be an excitement issue. I mean, I usually use a higher-pitched something. A lot of dogs will do that when they get excited about something. It's almost like a whine. Next.
Aurora, if a dog is whining in a down in a newer, high-distraction environment, do you let it whine as long as it's holding a double down? Is that the dog working through it and it'll go away with time?
I tend to address the whining the best that I can. Next.
Brooke, my dog is great at using his kennel when we are home, goes right in, calm, will usually sleep. Soon as we leave, he's crazy. He'll chew his crate to where he bleeds trying to get out. What do I do?
That's what separation anxiety is. So what do? You start the process of lowering your affection level with your dog when it's home. You start doing crate drills. You start setting up your dog with a nanny cam and a remote cower and correcting the biting of the crates. Because a dog can destroy its teeth. A dog can bend its bars. A dog can escape out of the crates. You start doing simple things such as crating your dog and then going into another room. Or driving away but having a nanny cam, or again cutting down on affection. It's a process. Sometimes it's a very long process. Next.
Twitch. I have a 9-month-old American bully, and I'm trying to find his working level. I see his muscles twitch, but he doesn't react. Can I get some guidance, please?
Your dog is feeling it. So remember, the working level doesn't mean your dog is going to do something. All the working level is the lowest level that the dog feels, the motivational level that you can now start doing something, giving your dog training. Remember, remote cowers are the remote cower is just there. Now you have to actually train the dog. So if you see the muscle twitching, you know the dog feels it. Therefore, that's the working level. It might actually be even too high.
Kathy, hi everyone. Late but here.
Oh, good, Kathy. We missed you.
Gretchen, I've done high-level corrections. No speech outside what's necessary, and he still thinks it's a game or cuddle time. But I'm definitely struggling with the affection, not from me, but with JM. JM is going through a hard time right now and wants to play with the dog, and I've given in because he's been told no all the time and will cry when I insist on him not interacting because it is almost never helpful.
I don't know what to tell you, Gretch. That sounds like family stuff.
Yep. Alex, I'm new to your channel. Is a halty head collar good for a 1-year-old American pit bull?
So I don't use head collars at all, so I can't really give you my opinion on them at all, but many, many trainers do. So you'd probably want to ask someone that uses one. So I can't give you any advice on them because I don't use them. Next.
Angela, my 3-year-old lab goes crazy when guests come over. Very friendly, seeking attention, but she is rude. How do I correct this?
So whether she's rude or she's being aggressive, it's still not acceptable. So you would do the same almost protocol that we would do with anything else, is you would stop all the arousal, teach your dog place, and have your dog go to place. And just have your dog watch and observe people being being in the room. Next.
Aurora. Oh, sorry, guys. How do you break through the constant state of arousal? I structure my house very permission-based via your videos. I've studied it all. My dog's always on leash and e-collar straight out of her kennel.
So usually arousal, a bonker is great for arousal. I think it's an overall lifestyle, though. I think there's a lot of things that people are missing. I think sometimes people pick and choose, but some of the harder stuff they don't want to do. And that doesn't mean that's not necessarily you. But, I mean, duration place is great for arousal. And don't get me wrong, I'm a huge advocate of lots and lots of exercise, lots and lots of structure. But I think a lot of times what happens is people are missing something, and it's usually duration work. That would be the big one. Next.
Yep. Alex, I actually saw your videos, didn't care for how much you cussed, so I finished the video and moved on. Then your bonking video came out, and I'm 100% Team Jeff.
Yeah, I tend to cut. Depends on the show. There are some shows that, like, I don't think I've cussed once this show. Mm-hmm. I said there's some shows that I cuss a lot, and there's other shows that I don't cuss at all, and then there's other shows that I cuss average. And sometimes it's not like something I plan on doing. Like, I'm going to cuss a lot this show. It all depends on what I'm talking about and some things I'm really, really passionate about and some things that just comes out. And, you know, and even with like, and Angelo's here and people are like, oh my God, your son's in the room and you're swearing. Angelo actually is like around me all the time and he doesn't swear at all. He knows the difference between what words he's supposed to use and what words he's not supposed to use just because I use them. You know, it doesn't, like, when you do proper parenting, like, your kids are not going to, like, just do everything you do. It's like, it doesn't work that way. I mean, do your children mimic you? I guess if you ever sat your child down and you explained to them, you know, the difference between right or wrong, I guess it would be. But, I mean, I'm not seeing, you know, Angelo drop F-bombs at all. And he's around me all the time. And I'm sure he's heard me say it a lot. And he's around you a lot, too. And you drop a lot of F-bombs, too.
Angelo's a good kid.
Yep.
He's like, I just don't do what they do.
Right. He's like, the last thing I want to do is sound like my dad.
No, but you know what? He said something tonight that did sound just like you. And I was like, aw.
But that's not an F-bomb.
No. He was like, it's going to be a great show. Because that's just how everything in life is. It's great.
Yes.
Angelo.
Yep, he's a really positive kid.
He really is. Like, you can't, like, I can't, I don't think I was raised like that. Like,
I think
it's so important to, like, instill that in your children.
We were talking about that today, about Angelo coming to work here today and if he's being served properly. And, like, we do our schooling and then he does his life stuff and he's exposed to a lot of other things. And Angela, you never did put up good content today, though.
Yeah, they never said they need my help with dogs.
Well, we got to get good content up tomorrow, buddy.
I'll be here. I'll make sure he gets some work.
He gets some content.
Kai, 11-month-old large dog, just added to the family. Never been on a leash. He's very timid and has a high flight drive. What to do when he runs away with the leash on? Do I fight him when he runs?
Yeah. Well, you don't fight him. You just make sure he has a long
plant
line
your feet.
On. Yeah, I think that it's a big disservice not to have. There's two different thought processes on that. Like, I mean, I personally think that I mean, when you were raising your dogs, you didn't put leashes on them, and your dogs turned out okay.
I got them at 8 weeks old.
Yeah,
it's totally different when they're puppies. They're scared to leave you.
Right.
So it's like, oh, you're going that way. I'm going that way, and you better follow me.
Right. I think that what do you do is like, yeah, you hold on for dear life, and you don't let your dog run away. Oh my God, I'm so sorry, guys. It's been a rough, weird week. Next.
DJ Young. Hi, guys. Thanks for all the content you put out. It has really helped a lot. My dog is growling at us when in her crate. What's the best way to correct? E-collar correction seems to just get her going more. I've gone to the max level. Hard to bonk when she's in a crate, obviously.
Well, I don't think going to the max level is that necessarily going to be what it's going to be, the dog's growling in the crate.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, what's this randomly growling or growling at you? Excuse me, and you can actually take a dog out of a crate and bonk it and put it back in. What I would say is, what's the rest of the day look like? I think a lot of people, what they're doing is they're not doing enough structure and leadership skills outside of the crate. And then when the dog goes in the crate, it's sort of like a free-for-all. Also, sometimes, is it because people are approaching the crate when you're approaching the crate? There's so many variables. I can't just give a blanket information on that. Next.
DJ Young, thanks for all the content you put out. This has really helped a lot. My dog is, oh shit, I just read that. Kai. This is the dog that flees. He doesn't mind a leash, collar, pull when he is calm and I'm leading him with treats until something sets him off and he freaks out and violently tries to throw the collar off. Also, just checked out your channel today. Really enjoying the content and availability. Thank you so much. Sincerely, a super effing stressed out dog owner.
Yeah, so I've got a lot of empathy for you and I feel for you. And we get a lot of folks like you who just join us. So what I would just do is I would say you just found the channel. Go through the channel. Start watching the videos. Start applying a lot of stuff to it. Start with a place command. Start with basic leash walk. Start with lots and lots of structure. Right now, be careful with your affection. A lot of people are like, oh, I'll build this affectionate relationship with a dog. You can build a relationship with your dog through work, though. Through the work, through the training. Next.
Aurora, I watched a documentary about Romania showing a brown bear swiping with its huge paw and slamming a wolf just to watch the wolf get up and run away. Yet we are hurting our dogs with our training tools.
Yeah, I think that, I mean, we can even make it even simpler than that. Like, my dogs run into shit all the time when they're, like, chasing things.
Mm-hmm.
They run into each other.
God.
I mean, I've heard two of my dogs run into each other, and I'm like, that must have really hurt.
Burton has barrel rolled across the dirt sometimes if he gets caught in the crossfire.
Of like a dog like running one way and he's going this way.
And then he just like gets up, grabs his ball and goes.
Right.
Like, and, Cooper.
And I can't tell you how many times I've thrown a chuck it ball and a dog is like run in front of the ball and the ball like nails the dog. It's not like I threw the ball at the dog. The dog just happened to be like in the wrong spot.
Mm-hmm.
Or the dog or the ball was in the wrong spot. And the dog does fine. I think I think we have to just be a little bit more practical sometimes next.
Blake, glad to see you guys back on. Missed ya.
Yeah, it's good to be back here too.
Mothman, a pet store was asking for questions on their Instagram, so I had to ask, do you believe in purely positive or do you correct bad behavior? They said, we believe in rewarding good behavior, ignoring what we don't want, and managing behavior we can't change. Trying to correct can backfire to where you are encouraging your dog to keep doing it. Bro, WTF does that even mean?
So I think that's an interesting ideology, and it really doesn't, I mean, to them it must make sense. They might want to stay neutral and not have anybody hate them, but it doesn't work. Ignoring bad behavior, I think, is a really silly idea. So every time your dog jumps up, let's make it really simple. So if I ignore a dog jumping on me, it's going to stop. Maybe eventually, but at what point does it stop? Like, have I been knocked down to the ground? Has Angelo been knocked down to the ground? I mean, we ignore what? Biting? We ignore barking? We ignore getting into the trash. We ignore, like, no. And it's like, and then stopping, correcting an unwanted behavior, backfiring.
We're making the dog want to do it more.
We're rarely ever seeing that if you know how to correct a dog. The problem is a lot of people just don't know how to correct dogs properly. Next.
Kathy started on driveway drills with my dog, and I'm fostering. Cool to compare the learning difference between the two. Thanks for posting that info. It's great help.
You're welcome. Driveway drills is a great little video and it's really, really important. And I think it just talks more, the bigger message is you just do all these drills. And I think a lot of people are not doing enough repetitions.
Aurora, are we allowed to ask Joelle fitness related questions on this show?
I mean, if you want to. Next.
Sure, I'll answer some. Maybe I should start doing a live.
Maybe. Go ahead.
Katie, hi J&J. I was wondering if you had any advice. Today I found out that my border collie is blind in one eye with a high probability that she'll lose vision in her other eye as well. She's 2 years old, highly food motivated. Do you have any extra advice for working with a visually impaired dog? She tends to be very anxious and worried about things.
Hold on.
Oh. Extra fearful of physical correction and loud noises. The e-collar has worked so well. I watch her training videos regularly and love the DIY 2020 playlist. Thanks in advance.
So thanks for the nice words. I think you can train it. So what I would do is just like turn your training into hyperspeed now. So even a blind dog, though, they can get around just fine. They can navigate a lot of stuff, especially in your house. They'll sort of figure out where things are. And then everywhere else, your dog could be on a leash. You can use odor as like around doorways and stuff, so your dog knows what door to go in and out. You can use your voice as well. But just do as much as you can now with the training so your dog understands the training if it does lose its vision. Next.
Kibu, husband had a GSD when he lived in Nova Scotia. Lots and lots of snow. He called his dog and the dog popped up from under the snow. Yep. He fell asleep and the snow buried him. Just think about a husky.
Yeah, think about huskies or Akitas or Pyrenees or a lot of the sheep herding dogs or perimeter protection dogs or bear hunting dogs, dogs from the Sheba family. I mean, a lot of dogs don't mind being outside.
Mm-mm.
They don't mind being outside for hours and hours and hours at a time. Next.
Shayna, we were in the street, people were staring, it didn't go well, never mind the dog objecting. I felt like objecting too. I think that's about the Pyrenees, maybe.
Oh, the objecting. Pyrenees. Yeah. So you want to probably try that in a lower distraction area. Next.
Dakota and Blessing, my dog still has some anxiety issues with other dogs when on leash. Absolutely no reactivity, and I correct whining. But I realized that after I stopped the reactivity, I skipped the positive association part because I started with that and it didn't work. So it's in my head that positive association and stuff like that didn't work. Well, other than for teaching obedience tricks or tasks.
No, you can create positive associations from past negative things. Once you stop an unwanted behavior, such as like being attacked by dogs, and all of a sudden you've stopped the dog's negative reaction to it, you can start rewarding the dog for being around other dogs and not exploding. You can absolutely do that. We do that all the time. Next.
Montserrat. Hi, Jeff. My 10-year-old Chihuahua gets pretty aggressive with our new 12-week-old Shorkie, particularly when treats are out. Even if the puppy isn't after them, she's not adapting very well. What would Jeff do?
So it's a 10-week-old...
10-year-old Chihuahua is getting aggressive with the 12-week-old puppy. Oh,
so I would stop that immediately, or else you're going to end up with a puppy that's going to kick the shit out of that 10-year-old Chihuahua, which is not that hard to do. What I would do is I would correct your 10-year-old Chihuahua with no and a bonk for doing that. You know, you really don't want anything negative to happen to such a young puppy at all, because you'll create a lot of hosts of problems. It sounds like you've got a resource guarding 10-year-old dog. So teaching the dog the out command, teaching the dog what no means, and then setting up your home with more rules and structure is probably going to be is highly advised. Next.
Debbie, hi, I'm new here and enjoying your videos. Question about your seminars. How many dogs usually attend and how much time is spent with each one?
Depends on the seminar. There could be anywhere from 15 to 20 dogs. Certain dogs get certain amount of time depending on the protocol, but then it's a combination of one-on-one training and then sort of like a groupish type training. But we address just about every question that you have with your dog. Your dog does get enough time. It's not like I stand there and I lecture for hours. It's like, I just don't do that. I talk for a long time, but it's sort of mixed in doing stuff with your dog. You should walk out of there with the skill set to be able to make your life with your dog better. Am I going to solve every single problem right there that weekend? No, nobody really can. But you definitely get, I think, more dog time than a lot of other places. Next.
Madison, I work at a dog training company. They are purely positive and hate that I use a prong on my dog. I can't imagine if they knew I use an e-collar. It's been a struggle since they're so close-minded.
Yeah, I mean, everyone's entitled to feel the way they want to feel. But, I mean, until they, do they know how great it can be by using certain tools? Sometimes people just don't know. Next.
Mothman, I had that same thing with the pet store puppy training. Deacon used to have a problem jumping up, and the trainer said to ignore it and have him sit instead. Once we stopped going, I corrected him for it, and wow, he stopped. I can't imagine just letting it slide because I would never want him to knock me over, especially anyone else.
Yeah, teaching a dog to sit does not stop jumping. Next.
Cody says, hi, Jeff and Joelle. Hello.
Hey, how are you?
Randy, hi, J&J. How was New Orleans?
New Orleans was okay. It was a little bit crazy for us. It was nice to see Sean and Marta. I was still coming down.
You were like not well.
I was still not doing physically well. I'm still recovering today. I still haven't had like a complete recovery yet. I'm still waiting for that to happen.
So shouldn't go to the gym tomorrow then.
We'll see.
Still feeling the fatigue.
Yeah, we'll see.
That shit can linger for, like, weeks.
I know.
Shayna said, you skipped the first part of my question. Oh. No. It might have been too long, so it probably didn't come through.
Yeah, sometimes if you type in too many characters, the question just disappears.
Kayla, hi, Jeff. I'm a new follower, and so far, greatly appreciating your videos for my anxious dog. I'm now fostering puppies and was wondering if you could put together a raising training puppy playlist.
I think what you should do is... we don't have a lot of puppies that come through here. So I think there are so many other people out there that have got puppy training videos out there that you should probably start snooping around the internet. And I like the fact that you'd want me to make them. There's so many videos, though, that we are backed up on, and we make them all for free and put them out for free. I think people have to just, like, whatever we put out, we'll have to accept. It's going to be a while before we do a raising puppy playlist, though. I will tell you that much.
None of us are getting puppies anytime soon, unfortunately.
Yeah.
I mean, if I must for the playlist. Just yes. kidding. I can't imagine having three dogs right now.
Yes.
Let's see. Cody says, I'm the one with the stitches. Is that a private conversation you have with somebody who has stitches right now?
Cody, somebody got 21 stitches in their hand.
Is that them?
Maybe. Sorry, Cody. I think that's, if that's what you're talking about, Cody, your dog was resource guarding you. Did I share that story earlier? Early in the show? Yeah. Cody, yeah, if that was you. Cody, if that was you,
they might just have never been on our show before, so maybe that's like they're referencing, like, so you know who they are.
Oh, okay, okay, I see, I see.
It's 8:30, but we got a $5 top chat from Montserrat. Thank you.
8:30 already? Okay. Yeah. So it's 8:30 already. We're gonna end the show again. We don't always get through every single question, so I appreciate everybody. What day of the week is today? Wednesday.
Wednesday.
So we're back when Saturday. We'll be back Saturday. Angelo is going to be doing his Pokemon show tomorrow, right? Angelo, Pokemon tips?
Yeah.
Tomorrow, 5:30? Mm-hmm. Okay, you want to come on the show and announce it?
Yeah, Cody said that's me.
Hurry.
Hurry up, Ange.
Come on, Ange.
Move those legs.
We got dead air time right here.
Puts his little shoes on.
Put his house slippers on. So Joel doesn't yell at him.
I just cleaned this office.
Hi.
What time is your show tomorrow?
5 o'clock.
5 o'clock? You want to do 5 o'clock or 5:30? It's up to you.
5:30.
It's up to you. 5:30. What's it going to be on?
Pokemon.
It's going to be on this channel?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So we'll see you tomorrow at 5:30. Nice. Okay, great. Get ready. But why don't you pack up your stuff? We're going to be leaving soon, okay?
Okay.
All right. All right, guys. Love you.
Good night.
Bye-bye.